This is the Catholic Daily Mass Readings and Reflections for the Pentecost Sunday. Today's first reading is from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, verses 1 to 11. The second reading is from Galatians, chapter 5, verses 16 to 25. And the Gospel reading is from John, chapter 15, verses 26 and 27, and chapter 16, verses 12 to 15. Thanks for joining today's Mass Readings and Reflections. If you are new to this channel, please consider subscribing to this channel. And don't forget to like the video and share it with your friends and family. First reading, a reading from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, verses 1 to 11. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly a sound came from heaven like the rush of a mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them tongues as of fire, distributed and resting on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound the multitude came together, and they were bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in his own language. And they were amazed and wondered, saying, Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us in his own native language? Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians, we hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Responsorial Psalm. Your response, Lord, send out your Spirit and renew the face of the earth. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are great indeed. How manifold are your works, O Lord. The earth is full of your creatures. Your response, Lord, send out your Spirit and renew the face of the earth. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord be glad in his works. Pleasing to him be my theme. I will be glad in the Lord. Your response, Lord, send out your Spirit and renew the face of the earth. If you take away their breath, they perish and return to their dust. When you send forth your Spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the earth. Your response, Lord, send out your Spirit and renew the face of the earth. Second reading, a reading from St. Paul's letter to the Galatians, chapter 5, verses 16 to 25. I say, walk by the Spirit, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other, to prevent you from doing what you would. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under law. Now the works of the flesh are plain: immorality, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, anger, selfishness, dissension, party spirit, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and the like. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law, and those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Sequence. Come, Holy Spirit, come, and from your celestial home shed a ray of light divine. Come, Father of the poor, come, source of all our store. come within our bosom's shrine. You of comforters the best, you the soul's most welcome guest. Sweet refreshment here below, in our labor, rest most sweet. Grateful coolness in the heat, solace in the midst of woe. O most blessed light divine, shine within these hearts of yours, and our inmost being fill. Where you are not, we have not, nothing good in deed or thought, nothing free from taint of ill. Heal our wounds, our strength renew, on our dryness pour your dew. Wash the stains of guilt away, bend the stubborn heart and will. Melt the frozen, warm the chill, guide the steps that go astray. On the faithful who adore and confess you evermore, in your sevenfold gift descended, give them virtue's sure reward. Give them your salvation, Lord. Give them joys that never end. Amen. Alleluia. Gospel acclamation. Alleluia, alleluia. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and kindle in them the fire of your love. Alleluia, alleluia. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John, chapter 15, verses 26 and 27, and chapter 16, verses 12 to 15. Jesus said to his disciples, "When the Advocate comes, whom I will send you from the Father, the Spirit of truth that proceeds from the Father, he will testify to me. And you also testify, because you have been with me from the beginning. I have much more to tell you, but you cannot bear it now. But when he comes, the Spirit of truth, he will guide you to all truth. He will not speak on his own, but he will speak what he hears, and will declare to you the things that are coming. He will glorify me, because he will take from what is mine and declare it to you. Everything that the Father has is mine. For this reason, I told you that he will take from what is mine and declare it to you." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Dear brothers and sisters, Pentecost is a great day in the church life. It is a celebration of Jesus' gift of the Holy Spirit to the church and to each of the baptized. Today we recall the powerful events in Jerusalem on that first Pentecost Sunday. Before then, the disciples were frightened behind locked doors. On Pentecost, the doors were open as they received the Holy Spirit in a drama of wind and flame and are suddenly unified by mission and purpose. They become confident and courageous. That Holy Spirit has remained within the church. If the Holy Spirit had not come, the world and the church would never have understood that the whole story of the crucified Jew from Nazareth was more than a provincial and historical insignificant event. In Acts of the Apostles, we read about the event of Pentecost. This account of the Holy Spirit visibly coming down on the disciples who, in keeping with Jesus' instruction, had stayed together in Jerusalem, gives limited information as to the time and place of the event. Yet, it is full of content. Pentecost was one of the three great Jewish feasts for which many Israelites went on pilgrimage to the holy city to worship God in the temple. It originated as a harvest thanksgiving with an offering of first fruits. Later, it was given the additional dimension of commemorating the promulgation of the law given by God to Moses on Sinai. The Pentecost celebration was held 50 days after the Passover, that is, after 7 weeks had passed. The material harvest which the Jews celebrated so joyously became, through God's providence, the symbol of the spiritual harvest which the apostles began to reap on this day. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 2, verse 3 and 4 we read, "And suddenly a sound came from heaven like a rush of a mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them tongues as of fire, distributed and resting on each one of them." Wind and fire were elements which typically accompanied manifestations of God in the Old Testament. In Exodus chapter 3 verse 2, we read about Moses' God experience. The angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, The bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. And Psalm 104 verse 3 says, "Who have laid the beams of your chambers on the waters, who make the clouds your chariot, who ride on the wings of the wind." Here in this instance, as Chrysostom explains, it would seem that separate tongues of fire came down on each of them. They were separated, which means they came from one and the same source, to show that the power all comes from the Paraclete. The wind and the noise must have been so intense that they caused people to flock to the place. The fire symbolizes the action of the Holy Spirit, who, by enlightening the minds of the disciples, enables them to understand Jesus' teaching, as Jesus promised at the Last Supper. By inflaming their hearts with love, He dispels their fear and moves them to preach boldly. Fire also has a purifying effect, God's action cleansing the soul of all trace of sin. Pentecost was not an isolated event in the life of the church, something over and done with. St. John Paul II, one of his homily during the day of Pentecost, said, "We have the right, the duty, and the joy to tell you that Pentecost is still happening. We can legitimately speak of the lasting value of Pentecost. We know that 50 days after Easter, the apostles gathered together in the same synagogue as had been used for the first Eucharist, and from which they had gone out to meet the risen one for the first time, discovering in themselves the power of the Holy Spirit who descended upon them, the strength of Him whom the Lord has promised so often as the outcome of His suffering on the cross. And strengthened in this way, they began to act, that is, to perform their role. This is born the Apostolic Church. But even today, and here in the continuity lies the Basilica of St. Peter in Rome, and every temple, every oratory, every place where the disciples of the Lord gather is an extension of that original cenacle. Vatican II quotes St. Augustine's description of the Holy Spirit as the soul, the source of life of the Church, which was born on the cross on Good Friday and whose birth was announced publicly on the day of Pentecost. Today, as you know, the Church was fully born through the breath of Christ, the Holy Spirit, and in the Church was born the Word, the witness to and promulgation of salvation in the risen Jesus. And in Him who listens to this promulgation is born faith, and with faith a new life, an awareness of the Christian vocation and the ability to hear that calling and to follow it by living a genuinely human life. Indeed, a life which is not only human but holy. And to make this divine intervention effective, today was born the apostolate, the priesthood, the ministry of the Spirit, the calling to unity, fraternity, and peace. Mary, who conceived Christ by the work of the Holy Spirit, the love of the living God, presides over the birth of the Church on the day of Pentecost, when the same Holy Spirit comes down on the disciples and gives life to the mystical body of Christians in unity and charity. That event of the Pentecost had great significance in our lives as well. In his first letter to the Corinthians, St. Paul reminds us that the Holy Spirit is given to the Church and to each individual Christian as well. He writes, "Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of service, but the same Lord, and there are varieties of working, but it is the same God who inspires them all in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good." 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3 to 7. In our day of confirmation, we all receive the Holy Spirit, and He is working through us. But very often, when we think of the work of the Holy Spirit, we select the extraordinary gifts of the Holy Spirit, such as people speaking in tongues and being gifted with healing or grand inspirations. There are also the ordinary gifts of the Holy Spirit that we can easily overlook. These are the gifts that bring inner healing to the broken soul, the gifts of the Holy Spirit that enable us to forgive, to have the power to be faithful to our promises and vows, the Spirit that can bring us back to a living faith, a renewed trust in God, the gift of the Holy Spirit that enables us to pray sincerely, honestly, powerfully. We take these gifts of the Holy Spirit for granted, they don't receive the attention of the extraordinary gifts, but they are more important. We can live without fireworks, but we cannot live without daylight. St. Paul calls these ordinary gifts the greater gifts because through them the Holy Spirit brings order, balance, and health to our souls. The sequence that we use today is an ancient reflection on the work of the Holy Spirit. Wash clean what is sordid, bring to life what is dying, cure what is wounded, loosen what is rigid, warm up what is frozen, straighten what is warped. This is the Holy Spirit at work deep inside us, taking the broken parts of us and putting them in order and unifying all our talents in a Christward direction. The Holy Spirit is our living connection to Christ. May God bless you all.